Hello, and welcome back to America's number one podcast, and the world's actually now.
The world's biggest podcast.
Biggest podcast, who wears the thong?
Okay.
If you were to put money on it, who's wearing a thong right now?
Me or not Ali? Me, probably you. I would put you over me. I'm still in my little granny panties stage of postpartum.
And we love that.
We love
a granny panty queen.
And it's funny because before babies, I never wore underwear. I was team no underwear, just not my thing. Like, why wear them? But, you know, after you have babies, you got to get into underwear. Things just, and it's weird because I didn't vaginally give birth, but still things just happen down there, you know? So.
Ooh, drainage.
Okay. Oh, my God. All right.
Well, if you think about it, like, gravity's.
Okay. I don't think they needed to know that. But so granny panties are for the win. Are you wearing underwear right now?
Wouldn't you like to know?
I always thought it was weird you never wore boxers. Like, so, is that a thing? Is there guys that are boxers and then guys that are just little whitey tighties? Because you're in the whitey tighties group.
Let's tackle it. So I used to wear in.
Oh my God, they're still calling anyway. You.
From my employer before COVID, when I got fired, I'm still getting calls.
That's wild. She sounded stressed. All I heard was,
some sort of investment acquisition.
You should have been like, yes, what can I invest in?
Probably.
Oh my God, that's crazy.
Yeah.
Like, I know.
High tea. Sorry about that anyway. We'll have to cut out because I can't have her voice legally, but we can have the me answering.
Yeah, we'll cut
but
there.
We just can't have her voice for legalities anyway.
So let's go back to whitey tighties or boxers.
So when I was in middle school, elementary school, I wore like the Spider-Man whitey tighties, you know, and all the fun ones you buy at Walmart or Target.
Yeah.
Soiled the crap out of them, mainly just threw them away.
Okay.
I had a pooping problem. It's not a big deal.
We've talked about it before. Don't give him chocolate, he'll shit his pants.
Then in middle school, I got into the boxer thing, and the fad was to wear plaid boxers. Everyone had plaid.
American Eagle, green plaid. Or Hollister? What was the...
Honestly, I don't know. It was generic.
Probably Abercrombie?
And then if you got fancy, some of the cool people had silk boxers. So that was like the cool thing to have silk.
Oh.
And I went through that stage, and then I think actually through high school I wore like the loose boxers, and then into my college days I wanted something a little more snug, keep everything in position. You know, everything was growing, so I just wanted to keep it together.
But you also wore leggings as pants. Like, there was no way
tight.
You could put boxers underneath.
Correct,
because
it'd be all scrunched. So now I wear what are called boxer briefs. And it's the trunk. They're called trunks. So they're actually like a high waist. I'd show you right now, but I don't want to get taken down for indecent exposure or anything like that. So they're a nice high bevel, very soft, and a nice waistband, very comfy.
It's funny because you get them in white and then they turn kind of yellowy. So that's when we know it's time to throw them away.
I don't, though. I've had these forever. They're really nice, expensive.
I'm just joking.
Expensive underwear, but I've had them for years.
Are they the Calvin Klein ones?
Calvin Klein.
Do you think
they're my favorite?
Yeah, I guess there's people out there that are like grown, like your age, grown men wearing boxers. Like, that's
100%.
Is that a thing?
100%.
I don't know because I've never seen you wear boxers ever. We've been together 8 years.
I don't like it loose there. Except when I go to bed, I sleep naked.
Yeah, we know that. Oh my God. And can we talk about that? Okay. So Josh sleeps naked and I'm like anti-naked. I think it's gross. I'm just like, why? Like, just put a pair of pants on.
And
just
I can tell you, there are studies out there. I'm not going to cite anything. If you want to do your own research, we can look into that. But us as humans are made to sleep in the birthday suit. It regulates our temperatures at night, and also it doesn't overheat our private parts, which can damage offspring potentially.
Okay, well, coming from the guy who we just changed our sheets and our bed and got a new bed, and when you flip the bed over you go, ooh, little pee stain.
There is a thing in another, I'm not going to cite any studies, but I think my issue is I don't think I have anything underlining. I pee a lot at night because I chug water right before bed.
Yeah, but if you had underwear on or pants on, we might not have had a little pee stain on the bed.
This is probably true, but I just flipped the mattress the other way whenever I changed this, and now it's on your side.
Thank you. But yeah, no. So Josh sleeps naked. And then Jagger obviously gets up through the night and Josh is the one that gets him. And I just see this naked body with a child in front of me every night. And I'm just like, why? And then I'm nervous because our camera, when you go down to Bendham, you see on the camera, what if someone hacks into our camera?
What? Great. You're going to have a bunch of videos of me with my, you know, whatever. If you want to look at that, go for it. I mean, I don't know. It could fetch a pretty price on OnlyFans.
It's funny because I open my eyes and it's just in front of me. It's just there. With
it's just a generic male part. I mean, doesn't look like any other, you know,
I know.
A little bigger than the usual one. But, you know, nothing else to it. You know, just the normal. A normal phallus.
Like, what about a robe? What if I got you a robe that you could just put a robe on?
I like being naked.
I know you do.
I love it. I walk around the house naked a lot.
I know you do.
I cover up now because we have small humans around the house, but I like at least my shirt off. I like to just be.
Guys, okay. I hope this doesn't get taken out, but I'll let you decide. I'll tell the story and then let you decide if you want to leave it in. You probably want to leave it in because you're a weirdo. But Josh was outside. He goes, when we go out, it was a sunny day. Mm. It was a couple days ago. We go, I look outside. He's got his shirt off and he's in his little whitey tighties. I'm like, okay, whatever. That's him, his briefs. We don't have neighbors like that. We have one, it's his cousin, so she never looks over. But she can't see, like our porch you can't see. So I'm like, okay, he's out there in his little whitey tighties.
Back porch,
soaking in the sun.
Deck, actually.
And then I get a call from my parents like, hey, we're pulling in your driveway. Because I asked them to get me something. Can we drop this off right now? And I was like, yeah, sure. I said, we're home. I look over, this man, this 33-year-old man is sitting like, I don't even know how to explain it. I hope you're watching this. He's on the deck like this on the chair, completely butt naked, tanning his bum hole because he said, what do you say it gives? It's sunning. It's called something. And my parents walk through the door and I'm like, Josh, I hurry up and I try to distract them and tell Josh, like, get your pants on. Like, you're outside tanning your butt. Like, hole. Like, not why? Well, I'm not like,
I again mean, I don't want to cite any studies. Oh, but do some research. Tan in the dark hole
and, oh my god,
it a lot of benefits. If you think about it, sunlight, if you have a cat, you have a dog, oh, any type god, of animal in the house, if there's sunlight coming in the house, they find that spot and they land. The sun is healing. It has healing properties. I truly believe that. Every time I've gone in the sun, I just feel wonderful.
But
and I just absorb
the rays. Your butthole doesn't need it.
It does, because that's the only part. Think of that. It's like a dark, sad cave, and it needs light. And when you give that light, eternally, because we are all human beings, and we might have to look up this term, the way we're born, we start with our bum hole. We are that type. If we want to look up
the
term.
Wait, you're saying as...
In the womb, us human beings, we develop from a bum hole. And it's a type of... can we look that up?
A fetus?
Mammals that develop from a anus is the... Yes, there's a term where we are that type. There's other animals that share that type of...
All right, so I just searched, do humans develop in the womb from the butthole? And and the first thing is, the mouth and anus are not connected in the development of the embryo as early thought. Animals often form either the mouth or the anus first, which is called blastopore.
But deutero is the one we are, humans.
Oh. Which came first, the butt or the mouth?
Stomas. I don't know how to say it. All right. Fun fact. This is just from Quora. Quora online. Fun fact. It says humans are, I don't know how to say it. Deuterostomes. Is that the right?
I have no, you're talking
which
to
means
the bird brain.
That when they develop in the womb, the anus forms before any other opening, which basically means at one point you were nothing but an asshole.
That was good.
Some
was
people good. Never develop Wait, beyond the stage. I don't know if it's
I'm
true.
I'm
going
to make that a TikTok.
That's amazing. So,
that's great.
There's other stuff in here. Maybe we'll look more into this. So, and if you have more information on this, we'd love to know.
They're just saying the butthole came first then.
I guess.
Before your mouth. Because your only other opening, your only other hole, right? Well, I guess your other private part.
Yep. The belly button is kind of a hole, technically.
No, that's where the umbilical cord is.
But a hole. Your nostrils, holes.
Oh, wow. Ears. Wow, I guess we have a lot of holes. Pores. Okay, you're going extreme. I'm thinking just like hole, like big holes.
I actually have that too, tetraphobia or trichotophobia.
Learn fear what holes, it's called it? First.
Trichta.
I have no idea.
Trichtophobia.
That was in an episode of American Horror Story.
I freak. Like if I see stuff like that, maybe there's something correlating okay,
I think that leads us into this episode. That's okay. Kind of what I want to get into. So I put on my stories. I do my let's chat with me. And I had a million people ask.
No, really?
No, I had like two people. But I thought it was great because I want to touch on it. They, we've talked about your anxiety a lot. And I think we should keep talking about it. And I think, you know, it helps a lot of people. But we really didn't go into depth of your biggest
specific phobias.
Phobia. And the biggest one that's been the most challenging for our relationship and for me to understand, and that is the fear of flying. And like I said, we've talked about anxiety overall, but I really want to dive deep into the fear of flying because I think it's way more common than we are aware or know, because a lot of people that we've talked to said they've had it. And mm-hmm. even just a couple of the DMs I got, they're like, I do the same thing, or my partner doesn't understand my fear. How are you guys dealing with that? Because when I said you had the phobia and you had this fear, a lot of the next questions were like, well, how do you deal with that? Like, how do you deal with not traveling? How do you deal with not flying and going places? And we had a lot of big fights early on in the beginning because I didn't understand. So I think we should just dive deep into it. So you want to do that?
Yep, let's fly into it.
Today's episode is brought to you by Stamps. When every person, moment, and penny counts in your business, you can't afford to take any of them for granted. Stamps.com gets it because for the last 25 years, they've been helping businesses like yours save time and money. So you can focus on your business knowing Stamps.com has all your postage needs covered with premium discounts and great rates. With Stamps.com, all you need is a computer and printer. They even send you a free scale, so you'll have everything you need to get started. If you need a package pickup, you can easily schedule it through your Stamps.com dashboard. And if you sell products online, Stamps.com seamlessly connects you with every major marketplace and shopping cart. Running a business isn't cheap, especially when it comes to fulfilling orders for your customers. But luckily with Stamps.com, it has huge carrier discounts up to 85% off USPS and UPS rates. Plus, Stamps.com automatically tells you your cheapest and fastest shipping options. For 25 years, Stamps.com has been indispensable for over 1 million businesses. Get access to USPS and UPS services you need right from your computer at any time, day or night. No lines, no traffic, and no waiting. So set your business up for success when you get started today with Stamps.com. Sign up with our promo code Herberts for a special offer that includes a 4-week trial plus free postage and a free digital scale. No long-term commitments or contracts. Just go to Stamps.com, click the microphone at the top of the page, and enter our code Herberts. That's H-E-R-B-E-R-T-S at Stamps.com. Now let's get back to the show. Today's episode is brought to you by Alo Moves. You guys know I'm a couple weeks postpartum and I'm ready to get back into it. I'm cleared, but gyms and equipment, they're overwhelming. They scare me. I've never been the person to be able to just like walk into a gym and know what to do, but now I don't have to worry about that with Alo Moves. Alo Moves is a streaming on-demand wellness platform that features yoga practices, fitness routines, meditation sessions, and so much more from one of my favorite brands, Alo Yoga. All their quality studio style classes inspire me to take care of my whole being, my body, my mind, my spirit, so that I can go into the world and do what I do best, and that is being a mom, so I can focus. And it just gives me that time to myself. We all need that. So they've got something for everyone, from beginner to advanced, yoga to bar, Pilates, cardio, HIIT classes. They also have relaxing guiding meditations, sound bath, and breath work. There's more than just fitness to Alo Moves. You have to check out their dry brushing, their face yoga, their nutrition classes, and so much more. And the best part is you need little to no equipment. That is my favorite part. So with Alo Moves, there's tons of fresh content with over 100 new classes added every month, plus over 3,000 classes, every level, beginner to advanced. I love how Alo Moves fits into my schedule. All classes are on demand. When I'm short on time, I can fit a meditation or a fitness class in whenever I need to squeeze it in. I love how Alo Moves fits into my schedule. All classes are on demand. So when I'm short on time, they have meditation, they have fitness classes, all for when I need to squeeze in that workout. And it's not just me that loves Alo Moves. It was voted best wellness app of 2022 in Style Magazine and best yoga app of 2023 by Wellness Health. For a limited time, Alo Moves is offering our listeners a free 30-day trial plus, get this, 50% off an annual membership. But you can only get it by going to alomoves.com and use our code Herberts in all caps. That's Alo, A-L-O, moves.com and all caps code Herberts, H-E-R-B-E-R-T-S, to get a free 30-day trial plus 50% off an annual membership. alomoves.com with our code Herberts in all caps. Now let's get back to the show. All right, Josh Herbert. So we know you are one of a kind. You tan your bum hole. You wear.
I try to. And you get try. Interrupted.
You wear whitey tighties.
No, briefs.
Briefs. And you have a phobia. I can't even say fear because I feel like people don't even understand the extent. So I hope you don't. Do you take offense when I say phobia? Or do you think that's better than saying fear? I don't know.
I think they're all one and the same. But I think mine's. Like yours more is like fear.
That's what I'm saying. Like, yeah. So I don't know what would be the next term.
I guess phobia.
Of flying.
Severe phobia.
And other little things like elevators mm-hmm. and things like that. But we can touch into that. But I think.
Caves.
Okay, well, we don't go to caves much.
Deep sea diving.
We don't go diving. I think a majority of people.
Submarines.
Okay, we don't
I'm
go
just trying to, you know.
Yeah. So things that you're enclosed in and can't get out
caskets.
Of.
Caskets.
Okay, well, I hope you're not in one of those.
Oh. Some people do that for fun at haunted houses. Okay. You ever hear that?
When you have a phobia of haunted houses too. That's haunted my houses. I miss going to Kennywood Fright Nights.
I don't really have a phobia of haunted houses. I just like dislike them.
No, you won't go. Remember we were in LA. We were in
I
LA.
I went to that one. The zombie thing.
That was the haunted mansion?
No.
Ride?
No, it was zombies. It was a haunted walkthrough with zombies. I went with you at Disney.
That's like
terrifying.
The haunted mansion.
Walking Dead thing.
Remember? Oh, that's a Walking Dead ride. It's a ride. It's
I didn't not, ride anything. I walked through.
Yeah, it's an attraction.
Rode my feet.
It was an attraction.
An attraction.
You literally
for who?
Were like this. Who's the whole way looking
that?
At every exit.
Well, I know legally they have to have exits at every so feet for safety,
so
for fire code.
We were in LA literally during Halloween. We lived right next to Universal. It's not called Fright Night there, is it? I don't know. Anyway, Universal puts on the biggest Halloween, scary, spooky, you know, haunted houses at Universal.
It's a spectacle.
We didn't go. We literally lived, oh my God, like, and that's my, I love scary movies. I love, like.
I do, I like Halloween movies.
Okay, this is this episode might be turned on me because I just realized I've given up a lot. I've given up my favorite thing ever.
Halloween Town on Disney?
No, scary movies. I love, like, my favorite, like, I love, Hills Have Eyes, or Texas Chainsaw Massacre, or
House
like,
of Wax.
House
I watched
of Wax.
That.
I did
that
love
okay.
House of Wax. That was my favorite movie. But
that
it's
one
not
was
scary.
Like okay, a little borderline scary.
Love scary movies.
You ever see The Descent?
Yeah, it's when they
that's
get down the cave.
That's probably the scariest
right?
movie I've ever seen. Yeah,
the cave one. Yeah, that's a good.
I've watched
one.
That.
Yeah, but like I scream. Like obviously those aren't that scary, but like Saw, like all those movies, I would watch for fun, and I have not watched one because of you. So sorry, we're getting off topic, but yeah, Josh is a fear of a lot of things. And when did you realize, or when did this fear happen for you, or phobias? Like, when did you realize, like, oh, I might be different than the normal person that can just jump on a plane?
Well, from as long as I can remember, I've always felt I was different. I would have... Yes, from as early as I remember, I knew I was different. I remember the earliest signs, because I've tried to just follow this back and back, lineages, past lives even, to just figure out what happened. But the earliest memories of this sort of anxiety feeling was preschool and being dropped off. And I remember having this extreme fear of, mommy, don't go.
Okay, I feel like
mommy, no. And I know a lot of children have it. Yeah. It's a normal thing, but I think mine was like, I didn't think she was ever
Are
coming
you being
back.
Serious? I'm dead no, serious. I can't tell. Okay, okay. Like, sorry, I'm going to get serious.
In my brain, I'm trying to like wire what happened. And I think my brain thought like, oh, she's leaving here. She's never coming back. Like that's how my brain took it. Getting dropped off for preschool.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
There has to be no explanation why I felt so extreme. So then it transpired into kindergarten. And my mom would have to drop me off and I would freak out. And some days she would just keep me home because like I couldn't be dropped off to preschool or to kindergarten. So then it kind of, you know, I was getting by and kind of developed. And then as I got older in elementary school, we'd have like school trips, like to these camps and stuff. I couldn't go. I couldn't sleep over friends' houses. Mm-hmm. I just had this fear of being away from home.
So you never slept over at a friend's house?
Never when I was little, no. And if I did, it was like on the rare occasion. And usually that friend was in my neighborhood. So like if some, I could just come home.
Yeah.
But I would do sleepovers, but I had a very tough time at first, especially if it was like a new friend I didn't really know. So yeah, anyway, struggled with that. I just had this attachment. Like I felt I didn't have anxiety like when my parents were there. Like I felt like they were my safety.
Yeah, but I was the same, similar, because I mean, I would stay at people's houses, but I definitely did not like being away from my mom. And my mom always said I would never leave her. So
But yours wasn't like severe. Like mine was like, I would like panic. I would start to get these panic attacks being away from home. And the only place that felt safe was home. So then through my life, we travel. We went on so many. I know you laugh at this, but like hundreds of flights.
Not hundreds.
In the 50s. We went every year.
Oh, I thought you meant 1950s. I was like, you were alive
in 1950. No, we would go on these Herbert vacations since I was like two. Yeah. My whole life. Every year we'd fly all over, you know, different destinations.
Yeah, there's a photo of you on the flight like this. Yep. When you're like three and we're so, like, what happened?
I remember too. And now we're getting to how the plane thing started. I remember like, I don't remember the really young flights, but the earliest I can remember, I used to get these really bad earaches because of the pressure, like severe. And so like, I think my mom would always give me like Benadryl or some sort of, I don't know, something before the flight to help. And it was more of like a placebo. And then it was, I forget where we were on vacation somewhere and we were on our way back. And I remember I was drawing pictures of sharks in my little notebook. And all of a sudden out of nowhere, left my body, cold sweats, heart, I felt like I was having a heart attack. And I'm trying to like, I'm looking around. All you hear is like the noise of the plane engine. We're over the ocean.
Yeah. How just, old do you think you were?
Probably 10, 11 years
now,
old.
Now, when did you stop flying? Like, did you fly throughout high school?
No. So then after that, I really struggled. And like my parents would go on trips, family vacations and stuff. And like, I avoided going for a long time. Like I couldn't go.
Like what age? Like,
this was in high school.
High school, okay.
Yeah, I really struggled. And that's, you know, you're growing and you're doing different things in high school. And none of my friends really knew I had like panic disorder, but I had trouble like sitting in a classroom because I'd get like panicky. So I'd always have to like go to the
bathroom. When you played hockey, did you have to fly for hockey or was it all bus?
No, it was all bus, but I struggled with that. And my dad came to like almost every trip.
I was just going to say your dad was pretty much.
He came to like every single
trip. And that made
it
easier.
Easier, yeah. I still had panic like. We go on all these trips in high school, and the crazy thing with somebody who has this, I didn't think about the game. I didn't think about my teammates. I didn't think about like, wow, this is such a sacrifice. My dad's like coming on all these trips with me. Didn't think about any of that. All I thought about was like, when we get to the hotel, I have to try to find the stairs without anyone noticing so I don't have to take the elevator. And that's what was on my mind the whole trip going to these trips, because I didn't want to be embarrassed that I couldn't take the elevator.
And it's weird because, I mean, we've been together 8 years. How long till you like told me these things? I don't really remember. I don't remember the like.
Well, I think I just like slid them subtly. Like, well, I don't like elevators.
I know we've talked about it. Like you would always say, I have a doctor's appointment.
Yeah.
Every week. And that was.
That's when I was going to therapy.
And then you were like, so weird. And I was like, oh no, that's fine. Like whatever. Like what? I think that's great. But I don't remember like the elevator thing or. Well, I do remember the flying. I remember our very first like big fight. We were together. We were living together. And I had the opportunity. This was after Josh went on tour.
Which I didn't fly on tour. We took
did not fly. RV. We drove. So,
which my dad drove it.
Josh's dad and his mom drove us to, we drove from Pittsburgh to Vancouver. And then I drove back with them. Like, we did not fly. I flew out one time, but that was with your mom. So like, I gave up my whole summer to be with you, to help you as much as I could. And then I had the opportunity to go to Miami like a couple months after your tour, and obviously to fly to Miami. And he was like, no, I'm not going with you. Go by yourself. And do you remember? I mean, I remember telling you, because I didn't really understand at the time. Yeah. I was just like, no, like, you're coming with me. I did so much for you. Give me a little bit, because I felt like I was like, why can't you just get on a plane and come with me? How easy is
Which
that?
Which actually, a lot of people that are like me, as hard as it is to hear, we need somebody like you. We need an Abby who doesn't feed in to the anxiety. There is a point where like you have to have sympathy for it and stuff, but you need somebody who pushes back against that, or else you're just going to keep falling back. You need people who push you and who make you go beyond your fear, because that's honestly, it's the only way to live with it. I'm never going to say overcome, because I still have it. It's a part of me and I've accepted that, but it's a open, not as scary part of me anymore, if that makes sense.
Yeah, like, no, you've so much better than what, because at this, you were like, no. And I hit him with the, well, then we're not going to work. Like, this isn't going to, if I have to, like, I can't live in Pittsburgh and not leave Pittsburgh for the rest of my life. I said, this will not work out. And I booked, you were like, fine, we'll go. And you panicked. It was a big fight. And we ended up going. And I don't want to say, I understand now, because a couple years ago, I'd be like, and you were fine. But you would always be like, I wasn't fine. I'm like, but you survived, you made it, you got through it. You weren't physically fine, you weren't mentally fine. But you got on the plane.
It's more of like a internal traumatic experience.
But that was our first time ever flying together. And after that flight is when I realized, oh, this is a bigger issue. I've never seen someone, like, I laugh now because I know the situation and it's not funny. It is not funny.
No, why are you laughing?
But like, I don't know, because I'm just thinking back. I mean,
that you think it's funny.
It's not funny, because I feel bad that that's what you're going through. Okay. I've never seen someone's heartbeat. Like, I saw his heart through his chest. Like, literally, it was going like this as we were on the plane. And he wouldn't talk. Like, he would not speak. And when I'd be like, Josh, are you okay? He'd be like, I'm like, are you okay? I'm like, you can speak. You can talk. I can't talk. And, like, gripping onto the side. And, like, he had to have... how many movies did we have downloaded?
So
we had to have at least 10. And the flight was a 2-hour flight, which is one movie, like a movie and a half. We had to have like 10 movies downloaded on the computer. It had to be in his lap. He had to be focused on something the entire time. And I'm like looking out the window, and I was like, okay, this is serious. And then we were fine the whole trip. And then like the day before we had to fly, your whole mood changed. It was like white, like, I've never seen someone so pale. Like, you just got so white and pale. And finally, when we got home, I was like, okay, like, this is a bigger deal than it is. And I told him, you need to work on it. Because once again, I was like, I understand what you're going through, but you need to either go to your therapist again, you need to go talk to someone, because we can't live the rest of our lives only in Pittsburgh. And I don't know if that really got through to you, because you didn't really fly again after that. But my work picked up. So to be honest, I was just so used to traveling by myself. I actually genuinely enjoyed traveling by myself. So to me, I didn't really think much of it for like 2 years, because you couldn't go to, I mean, I guess you could have gone to jobs with me, but it didn't make sense. And you were fine with me going on a plane every other day and being gone. And it worked for so long. And then we got married, and it's like, well, what do you do on your honeymoon? You don't stay in Pittsburgh for your honeymoon.
It's not bad.
So where did we go?
Disney.
We went to Disney, because that's the furthest place I could get Josh to travel. But it was fun. But that was also a big thing. I still have the photo of you in the airport lounge. Like, you
barely able to eat.
I mean, it's crazy. Like, what do you go through? So that I experienced what I saw. So what do you go through?
So it's a very it's that traumatic of an experience internally that you like want to avoid it with everything in your being. So obviously it's very scary, but for my experiences, a lot of it's the pre anticipatory. Oh man, I gotta go to the airport. Just even being in the name airport, thinking about the hubbub of luggage clicking, clacking against the tiles, and just all those sounds is very triggering. All the people messing around, everyone's in a rush, is just very, very anxiety prone. And even just thinking of that at the house, like,
I would say it starts with packing.
Like, starts with packing. Oh, getting my bag, packing, you know, trying to do everything. So, okay, you get there. When I feel a little bit of calmness is when we get through security and all that, and we're at the gate. Okay. All right. Kind of made it to point A, right? And there's a little bit of calmness, but now it's another wave of anticipatory, because now I got to walk on this metal bird that somehow flies in the air, which humans, I don't think we were ever made to do that, but I'm not going to get into that. But anyway, now I'm like, oh my God. And this is before I tried any medication or before alcohol. This is my experience before any of that, just me with anxiety on a plane. I would go on the plane, walking in, just hearing the sounds, the high pitch, like, of the plane. Mm-hmm. You know, you're just all these people chitter chattering, people trying to find their seats. You get in, okay, boom, you sit in a seat. Then there's people right here just passing you, right? And you're just trying to get set. Okay, now in my head, I'm like, I can't get off. So now this sense of like being trapped, I'm not going to be able to get off. I'm going to be very high in the air, and I just can't. What if I need a breath of air?
Like, what if you have that anxiety attack?
Like, if I'm on a bus, I can be like, bus driver, stop, I need to get some air, and they can like pull over.
You can open a
window or like something, just fresh air, just chill. Here you can't. You're stuck. You're really high in the air. You can't just like come down. And then there's another wave of like anxiety that's like, I don't want to cause a scene. Like, mm-hmm. if I freak out, like, I don't want people to like, you know, I don't want to cause a scene, like emergency landing, like handcuffed, like, because I'm freaking out. So then there's that part of you. So we start taxiing. Heart rate's elevating a little bit. Mm-hmm. Okay. Worst part for me is takeoff. I feel like I'm on a strap to a rocket ship going to the moon. That's just what my brain.
No, I know.
I feel like I'm going straight up.
Like, I look over
to
and
the,
he's like,
to the freaking stars. Like, that's what I feel like. Yeah. Just maybe we'll never come back to Earth in my brain. Like, I'm just thinking, gone out into the universe. So boom, there's that. That's when my heart's like accelerating. Everything's going nuts. And then we start to level out. And then seatbelt sign goes off. Like, I'm like, okay. But then I'm like, okay, now I really can't get off. Like, mm-hmm. there's no stopping.
And see, for me, I mean, not that I don't have not that I have anxiety, but you always get a little something feeling. Takeoff for me is like, okay, we're going up there. But as soon as that, like, we're up there and it's like seatbelt signs off, I'm like, okay, cool, we're good. And that's funny because for you, it's like,
well, now I'm like,
you are stuck.
Now we're stuck here for how long till we can get off? Like, there's no, you can't get off.
That's crazy.
Unless I cause a scene and freak out.
Which you've seen on Twitter. Like, it's happened.
Because I can see, it takes a lot of, if you don't know what a panic attack is and you just have one, I can see why someone would freak out, because it feels like you're dying. And what happens, like the worst times I've had it, it's like depersonalization, if you will. When I'm sitting there, it's the most extreme fear you've ever felt. You feel like you're dying. Like, you feel like this is it. I don't know what's going on in your body. Fight or flight is telling you to get off, but you can't. So you're almost like accepting doom, and you kind of, in my experience, I've gone out of my body. I've seen myself sitting on the plane, and the scariest part is I felt detached to who I was or who I am as a human being. I felt very scarily like non from any of this planet, not from this universe. Don't recognize anyone as people. Yeah. Don't even know what a person is. Like, I can't even begin to fathom it, but it's very scary.
And for you, it's not, is it like, I hate to get morbid here, but it's not like, oh my God, this is going to go down. It's, I just can't get off. Like, is what, like,
that's
what,
in the back of my mind as well.
Well, yeah, but sure. Like, what is it, like, the biggest thing is just being,
I think,
stuck.
The biggest, I think where it all stems is the fear of death.
Okay.
And I've gone over everything. And I think all
the
of
control,
my panic
control.
Yeah. I think all of my panic is surrounded by the fear of dying, which everybody, I mean, a lot of people have. It's obviously we're all destined to. Mm-hmm. We're born and we die. But I think I have an extreme fear of dying to such an extent that it causes these phobias. So I think that's where it stems from, because when I'm having these attacks, I'm like, oh my God, I'm going to die. Mm-hmm. And that's why I'm scared, mm-hmm. because I'm thinking I'm going to die. It's not like oh my God, I'm going to throw up. Oh yeah. my gosh, I'm going to pass out. It's like, I'm going to die.
Yeah.
And that extreme fear of like, what's after death is Got what it. All this stems from. So that being said, on top of all that, then on the back burner of anxiety, I'm like, what if this crashes? What if we're going into a crash landing? Like, mm-hmm. how is this thing up in the air right now? Like,
yeah.
And I know airplane travel is very safe, much safer, but
have you seen that TikTok where they said it's like jello or something? Yeah. I haven't watched it, but I've seen people talk about it.
Which I'm totally fine. Like, I know they're safe. I've talked to so many people. The statistics are there to back it up. I think it is part in that you're not in control. Like, when you're driving a car.
I was just going to say, what about driving a car?
Because you're in control of your car, but obviously you're not in control of everyone else's. You have to be aware of a situational awareness of everything. And I think even being on a plane, you have to have that as well. Just, you know, I'm always like looking at the cabin, just, you know, just yeah. like, everyone okay? Like, you know, the pilot's good. But
see, I hate turbulence. When turbulence hits, I just look around. If no one else is reacting, then I'm cool.
What's crazy is that doesn't really bother. And I'm not even kidding. Right. It doesn't bother me because I'm already like, it doesn't matter. I'm already like, this is like, and so that being said, I get through all that. Landing is such a relief for me. Whenever we're going into a descent for landing, mm-hmm. it's actually like a lot of people fear landing. Mm-hmm. I'm like, as soon as it gets closer and closer, I start getting more chill. And as soon as we go, it goes really fast and then breaks and then it goes, I go, and it is honestly, it is like if you've ever had panic disorder or anything, when you land on an airplane or your biggest phobia, it's like the biggest, like I get off there and I feel like I could do anything. Mm-hmm. Maybe not skydive or like, yeah, something like that, but you feel just like you could conquer anything. It's like such a good feeling, even though you just went through all that, but you do feel drained mentally, physically, like you feel like your muscles hurt because you're so tense.
Now that you're 20 days, use the word sober, or not 20, 200 some days not drinking, and that was your way
I'm
of
actually
how many now
125 days.
I thought you were 200.
January 1st I haven't had a sip, so it's 125
days. 125
days.
Well, I hope you get to 200.
Yeah.
And no that alcohol. Was your thing
of, so then going into, can I get into medicating? So I had a big opportunity, and my cousin was wrestling in the 2012 Olympics, and my whole family was going to go see him. And he's, you know, my idol, my hero. I'm like, I can't not go, but I hadn't flown in like years prior to that, honestly. Mm-hmm. So we went to my doctor. He prescribed me some sort of tranquilizer. I'm not even kidding. It was a tranquilizer.
I know. Every time you say this story,
I got to get the name of it. I'm like, but it was a tranquilizer pill. And I probably didn't listen to the directions. I was freaking. We had to fly on this little puddle jumper to New York, and my sister was sitting next to me, and I was just freaking the whole time. Landing in New York, I was like, I can't do this. So I was like, I can't get on this plane to London. Like, mm-hmm. I'm freaking. So I pop one of those tranquilizers, and I go to the bar with my dad, and we have like three shots of Southern Comfort. Probably shouldn't be drinking on.
Probably not.
On this.
No.
So highly advised, do not drink while you're taking medications. You'll see why. So we're on the plane. I'm still freaking, bugging out. I take another pill, and I hit on the back screen. Like, my sister Kate's next to me. Big plane. It's like three rows, four rows, and then three more rows.
Yeah, anything. Those are the best.
It's like Airbus 360 or whatever. And I remember like looking at the screen. There's a couple movies to pick. I'm like, okay. I felt a little bit of safety. My whole freaking family was on the plane, like 20 some Herberts on the plane. So I'm like, okay. This thing goes down, we're all going down together. Like, but you know, there's like a safety thing there. Like, oh, we're all going out together, you know? But that's so sick to say. But it was like, it felt safe because my whole family was there. So, but statistically saying, we're good, we're safe, even though we're going over the Atlantic.
Okay.
Anyway, so I'm on the screen and I'm going through the lucky one, Zac Efron. I hit play. Okay. I'm not even making this up. I don't remember takeoff. All I remember is the flight attendant.
Same thing.
Kept coming with the cart. Yep. Budweiser. Yep. But like, I just remember, I don't know how many. And all of a sudden, my sister taps me on the shoulder. She goes, Joshua, look, it's London. Or like something like that, or Ireland. I forget what we passed first. And I look out the window. I'm like, did I fall asleep? She's like, no. I was like, what? What have I been doing? She's like, you were just like staring at, you're watching a movie, like drinking some beers, and I was like, how long has it been? She like told me, I literally, from the time I picked the movie to when my sister tapped me, felt like 3 minutes.
Sounds like a great Percocet.
But here's where the story goes south. So mind you, I hadn't slept almost 2 days before this flight because I was so anxious about the whole thing. Sleep deprivation added into all of this. We land, we get to the hotel. I'm like exhausted. I'm so tired. You can't sleep. Have you ever been there like that sleep deprived? My body's just like wired, panicky. The next day we're taking the Eurostar underground to see the Eiffel Tower. We had like the day. So it wasn't our whole family. It was like half our family and a couple friends who came on the trip. And I then, on top of all this anxiety, just flown, landed. I had anxiety about getting on this train because I couldn't get off, and then going under the channel.
Yeah. Oh my.
Underground.
Yeah.
This is like how.
No, nuts, I know. You know, I've like been with you for 8 years. I know.
It's like it's really debilitating, like, cycle. But yeah. Then I couldn't sleep because I was so worried about this train going under the channel. Oh, I can't. Oh my God. Like, this, how fast does this train go? You can't get off. Lo and behold, we get on the train, and that's actually beautiful. Like, I'm actually having a great time. Then it gets dark and it goes under. I'm like, it's like 20 minute trip under. And then you come back out and it was like beautiful. Like, I loved it. Train, I could ride all day. Mm-hmm. We land there. I had a fantastic, terrific time sightseeing all over Paris, Paris, got to see everything. And then all of a sudden, all those pills, everything, I think just like wore off, all the alcohol. I literally like couldn't move. Yeah. I had my feet up at a bus station. I had to be like carried back to the train. I've never felt that weird in my life. I feel like I was on the cusp of like, I needed like flu. I needed to go to the hospital, like 100%. But then I have a fear of hospitals.
Yeah.
So yeah. I couldn't do that. We were in a foreign nation. I was like freaking out. I felt even more displaced. I was like, I felt like I was going to get like, I don't even know. But we get back to the hotel and like, it got so bad. I started then have the effects where you're standing, but you feel like you're on a boat. Mm-hmm. Vertigo. It's very scary. Like just standing on solid ground, you just, it's terrible. And then that wouldn't end. Finally, I was able to calm myself down back at the hotel in London. I got a full night's sleep. I was able to enjoy my trip until the flight back,
which I was going to say then,
which I didn't take any of those pills on the flight back. I just drank.
Yeah.
So, but now skip ahead. I used alcohol as my,
well, so you told that story because that you never took a pill again to get on a flight. That was
until,
your like,
end. Well,
yes, that's okay. That's so you told the story.
So here's the thing. You have to trial and error. So I took pills and drank. Didn't work. Then fast forward to our honeymoon. I got absolutely blitzed on Southern Comfort.
Oh, my God. I mean, he literally
just smelled like
all he had to do was go like this. And like it would just hit you, the alcohol. But he wasn't drunk because it was literally because his anxiety was so high. It just brought
it just
him.
Just like calm. I wasn't drunk at all. It just like calmed me.
But he should have been passed out from how much he drank.
But that's like how my body was just like funneling it. But it helped me. I feel like in a way, yes, it did help me like just chill, relax. I was able to like look out the window, listen to some John Mayer, like hang out, like, oh, this isn't bad. And then landed just pulsating headache.
That's so right funny for you that eye. You thought you were hanging out because you were still like this the whole time.
Yeah, but for me, it's like, it's better. But then with the alcohol, like especially the hard liquor, that's why I don't drink hard liquor anymore. But right above the eye, right here, terrible headache, like upon landing.
It ruins the day.
Ruins the day. Like just feel like you're hungover by the time you land. And then you gotta just keep drinking.
And then you gotta go to Disney.
Yeah. So that's how I would get through it. And like that became my ritual because then it became, well, I can't fly unless I'm drunk.
Well, after our honeymoon, 2019, you didn't fly again. We did not go anywhere. He never flew again. Then quarantine, COVID hit, world pandemic. In Josh's mind, as much fear you had of the actual like illness, it was the best thing in your mind because he never had, like, you were like, we're never leaving.
Can't go anywhere.
You can't go anywhere. I can't, like, for him, honestly, I really think you thought, like, obviously I'm so glad people aren't sick anymore or to the extent it was, and I don't know what's going on with all this stuff, but like the world's getting back to normal. And in your mind, I think you thought it never would. Like, you were like, never leaving again, never have to fly. So then fast forward to 2022, we had the opportunity to take a partnership, and we had to travel for it and go to LA, and it was in Joshua Tree. And you immediately said no. And I said, Josh, like, no, like we have, like if we keep saying no, and this was like not the first time we had the opportunity to travel, but he kept saying no. And I was like, sure, whatever, whatever. I was pregnant. Then we had a newborn. Finally, I was like, there's no excuse. Like we have to do this because once again, I am not living my life stuck in Pittsburgh. I understand we're not going to be the ones traveling every month or traveling, you know, all over the world, but yet. Like yet, but I was like, we have to do this. And, I don't know how it worked. Well, I mean, I didn't give you an option. I said, we're going.
I think as I got older, I've been able to develop tools to combat it. I know what's going on. Breathe through it. It still sucks. Like, I'm not going to lie. We're going to be flying in June here to LA.
In 2 months.
I have a little bit of anxiety right here about it, but it's back here. I'm sure it'll grow. But that being said, what I found works for me is now 33 years old, not afraid to admit it. And if this helps anyone, I don't take any medication. I had a bad experience taking medication daily or as needed. I hate
Josh
it.
Josh doesn't even take Tylenol. He won't take Tylenol.
I barely take Tylenol. I just try to do everything naturally. It's just how I am. But if medication works for you, that's great. But what I do, I believe it's 1.5 milligram.
I'm not sure.
Or 0.5 milligram. I got to find out on the dosage, but of lorazepam. I take it a half hour before my flight when we're sitting at the terminal. Kind of calms me down. And if need be, I take one more during the flight or whatever, if it helps. But what that does for me, I am so aware still as if I am like sober, nothing's in me. What it does for me is that anxiety, think of it as a gas pedal. It doesn't allow that panic to come up. It's here. The panic's starting. It's trying to rise. It suppresses it. And just like, it acts as like almost like a brake, a governor on the gas pedal, if you will. And I found that works. It's working for me.
And you only took it when we did our flight. And the thing is, we're in Pittsburgh, and we don't have a direct flight to LA. So that also is even harder for someone like Josh with anxiety, because you get off, like you said, you get off that plane, and then he's got to do it all over again. So that's why we were like, the alcohol can't be it. So you got you actually were having heart palpitations and having all this stuff happening. We went to he finally went
got my heart checked. I thought
family doctor who checked his heart, checked all his levels, and he was like, you're fine, but you're experiencing anxiety.
Extreme. I had it so bad. I was getting these little like very sharp flutter in my heart, like kind of get tingly all over. Just feel like your heart's like, I never had it before, but it's just extreme amounts of stress, extreme amounts of anxiety on the body.
And that was when you were heavy training for the Ironman. You knew this trip was coming up and all this stuff.
I was drinking a lot.
You were drinking a lot. And the doctor was like, here's lorazepam, because you told him we had the flight coming up.
And I didn't want, the reason why I went that route, because I'm like, you know, weigh it. What's worse, drinking alcohol or trying to take these little pills that may help just for the flight.
And it did. We went to LA. We had my mom with us. So that was nice, because she helped with Poppy. And I told him, obviously, I would focus on Poppy. So Josh sat and played
Zelda
Breath the whole
wild.
Flight.
But what helps me too, if people are listening, one, the lorazepam, consult your doctor if you're going through something. But for somebody who has extreme fear, like top fear flying, I was able to get on a plane. Yes, I have tools now to help me deal with it naturally, just from my years of having it and going on planes, fighting that fear. And I kept going on. It might have been years at a time, but I kept going back. So that being said, what helps me as well, download a movie. Sometimes I like to watch new movies, but sometimes it's good to watch movies you like, or like you've seen before, you kind of know what's coming. Just helps that like shock values. You're not getting your, you know, blood pressure up or anything, like some exciting scene. So finding like a movie that really like calms you or something, and just focus on it. Noise canceling, earphones helps. And I just kind of stay, hey, I just have to watch this movie. All I have to do is sit here and watch this movie. That's all I have to do.
And you're in a playlist. You have your takeoff and landing playlist you play all the time.
Yeah. And I have a playlist with like the Beach Boys, real calming music. So I always have to drink. I always have water. Always bring water with you. I take these huge things. I fit in my backpack, so I have like way too much water for a plane. But I just sip on it.
And I know financially, it's not like this for everyone. But we actually spent. This was our first time doing it. We spent extra money to be in first class on this flight, because we knew it was the longer flight and the more comfort for him. Which it helped out with Poppy anyway. So
That's another tip. Okay, and a lot of people are like, oh my gosh, like I can't pay that much for flying, but when you have a severe phobia, no price matters. That seat could be 10 grand.
For us, it helped. Yeah.
If it helps, and I know it's, you know, financial situations, yes, but flying first class for me helped because I felt like I had a little bit more room mm-hmm. to like breathe, to like look around. Whereas the past couple flights, I was in the middle seat mm-hmm. with Abby and like a stranger.
God. Yeah. That and probably the stranger's didn't help.
Probably like, what is this guy? What is this going on? But so yeah, find a movie, focus in. And then it's so funny, I always have to go pee so bad on the plane. And like, that's another fear of mine. I'm like, oh my God, I'm gonna get stuck in the lavatory because it's like a little door. Yeah. And so it's so funny. And this is the only way I know how to express this. Imagine this. This is how I feel. Okay. Every time I have to pee, I'm in this world of like movie, earphones, can't hear anything. All of a sudden, I'm like, I gotta pee. So I'm eyeing the lavatory. Which one's closest behind me or there? Okay. I'm eyeing it up, looking around. I'm eyeing it up. Okay. That person got out. Here I go. I'm taking off my headphones, putting the movie down, put the thing up, unbuckle. I get up. I'm on a spacewalk. I was just on the space shuttle and now I'm out on a spacewalk, okay. Out floating in outer space. That's how I feel. I get in the lavatory. Sometimes I don't even lock it. Like if someone sees me, because I don't want it to get stuck. And if someone just comes in, like my back's to them anyway. Yeah. I have a real fear of locking it.
I locked it. Last flight we went on, I locked and I couldn't get it. And I had a little, it was with my mom to New York. That's
now,
what it was.
That I do lock panic. It now because I've realized it's a flimsy door. Like if I really needed to get out, I could do something. I'm sure they have some sort of tool, you know, the flight attendant probably have a tool to get in there. But, so I do my thing. I rarely flush. I'm sorry. Like it just scares me. Like,
that you're going to get sucked.
You know, I just feel like the plane's going to fall apart. So I don't flush. But it's just a quick pee. Sanitize up, always get back in my seat and then.
Yeah. And it worked. And to be honest, I would say this last travel experience to LA, we flew into LAX, flew out of LAX. You were very calm. Our flight, gosh, was at 6 a.m. from Pittsburgh. We got up at 3 a.m. Like for my mom to experience it, she was like, wow, like Josh was like not present with us. I said, yes, but that's what he needs. You had to just stay focused in your mind.
I'm fighting a fight in there.
And I said, it was honestly great. And then, actually 2 months later, we flew to Nashville.
Which was my decision.
Which was his decision. And it was we bought the tickets the night before, which is like, for him, crazy. And then it was just us with Poppy and we survived. We did it and you did great.
And too, people ask me too with this anxiety and panic. They're like, oh my gosh, it's got to be worse now that you have kids, right? Yes and no. But I would say my anxiety has gotten far less, my panic far less since having children.
Yeah.
And for me, this may not be for everyone, this is why. Because I think all this stems obviously from the fear of death and the fear of unknowing. Like, but when you have children, your selfish feelings of all this anxiety and, I'm going to feel like this, it kind of dissipates because your focus is on these tiny little humans now. Mm-hmm. And there's not a fear of like unknowing, like, wow, I made this beautiful daughter, now beautiful son. Wow. Like you kind of feel, this is, you know, you've made it in a way, like, mm-hmm. Oh, wow. Like, you just feel so fulfilled where now the fear of unknowing, the fear of anxiety is not there anymore because you're just like, I'm content. Like, this is so wonderful. And it's kind of like an acceptance of that fear of the unknown.
Yeah.
So that being said, it's actually gotten easier for me to do things. It's a lot harder preparing for it with a child, like getting on the plane with a child, but in the grand scheme of things, having children has lessened my panic.
Well, we'll find out how it's going to be because like Josh said, we're traveling in 2 months.
We are live streaming the whole thing. Could you imagine? That would be a hit.
And that was a thing. And people were like, why don't you vlog your trip to LA? I'm like, you don't understand. We can't. Like, that's the last thing we can focus on.
But I'm getting better and I want to get better for not only myself, but to be better for Abby and my family. And I think it's realizing that, and you can either do one of two things. You can either fight against the fear or you can retreat. And I'm not a retreater. I'm a fighter, baby.
And I think that's great for people because like it's a common thing to have a fear, phobia. You're not the only one in the world. Cause that was the number one thing too for you. I kept reminding you, Josh, you're not the only one in the world that's afraid of flying or has this fear. Like, there's more people out there than you know. And because I think you thought you were the only one.
You feel that way.
You feel like you were the only one. So, like you said, you either go get a therapist to give you those tools and techniques for the breathing and the mind focus you need to get on the plane. And then you have, you know, if you need that
toolbox of tools,
if you need that next step of medication or whatever that might be. And then, like you said, just pushing yourself to do it, because you got so comfortable saying no, not on a flight, that it was probably even harder for you to get on that first flight than it would be for us to fly every couple months, just to get that, you know, to get that feeling, because we haven't flown in a while. So, but you're doing great.
I think it's a testament though to a lot of people. Just one more thing I want to touch on. Mm-hmm. A lot of people with anxiety, and everyone thinks anxiety is bad. It's not. Anxiety actually can be a positive thing too, because more attention to stuff, you take more time perfecting things. Like, it's not all bad. Actually, statistically, people with anxiety live longer because they're more careful.
You got a lot of statistics.
That was from Doc Amen, I think. Wow. He said something like that. I don't want to misquote him, but anyhow, a lot of the things in my life have been my biggest fears, but I've done them. Mm-hmm. Singing in front of people, huge fear, did it on a pretty big stage. Swimming in open water, huge fear, did it in a crazy rapid lake, Erie. Biking 56 miles, like I did the half Ironman. That was, I didn't think, like, I was like, can your body do that? Like, oh, my body's gonna shut down for sure. Did it. Yeah. So I think there's something to say with people with anxiety and overcoming things.
I just thought of something terrible I said to you during the time. But just the Ironman, because I could not believe this man would do a half Ironman but not get on a plane, because he was kind of fighting the plane anxiety or getting on the plane to our last LA trip last year. And I was like, dude, you're more likely to die doing an Ironman or doing the half Ironman than getting on a plane. Do you remember? You'd be like, oh, well, thanks, Abby. Thanks for telling me that.
Well, I think, too, it comes down to then the control thing. Like, I'm in control.
But no, because that's what we were talking about with our friends. Like, in my mind, doing an Ironman is a million times scarier than getting on a plane. But for you, it's not.
Well, I just had a friend here. He's like, I can get on a plane all day, but getting in the ice bath.
Like, who would want
to
do that?
He's like, I'm not doing that. And I tried to think of it in context. And I don't know. I think it's two different things, but we're going to get him in the ice bath.
And for someone, if you have a partner, like if you're like us, where one has severe anxiety and one not so much, like you just compromise talking to each other. Because if I sat here and just, and I hate using the term, there's going to be a better term, like not babying you, but
belittling,
like,
me,
not be, no, like giving, if in. I, giving into your anxiety and letting you, your anxiety win
sympathy,
it would just, yeah, it would be not, it wouldn't be
it
good
would
for
grow
either
in
of
a
us.
bad
it just wouldn't be good for either direction, of us. So I think compromising, talking it out, like, he knows my feelings, he knows, like, I don't want to travel every day, but he knows, like, you know, I do want to be able to just go to Florida for a family vacation or go to LA for work trips, and you're taking those steps to do it. So I think, like I said, just being vocal.
And also, I think normalizing.
Yeah.
A lot of people are afraid of doing things like with panic attacks and panic disorder because they're afraid what people think. It's an embarrassment.
Yeah.
Here's the best way to overcome it. Nobody really cares. And if you're in a situation where you're having a panic attack, whether you're in a conversation, you're at a grocery store, you're somewhere, I know it sounds embarrassing, but it will lessen the hold that this anxiety has over people. Hey, I'm having a panic attack real quick. Like, hey, hang on. No one's going to be like, oh my God. Like, people are going to be like, oh, what do you need? Like, do you need what? Like, 99.9% of people are going to do something to help you and not judge you. And it's all internal what people are going to think. Oh, this is so embarrassing. You're at a job, you're in an interview, getting panicky. Hey, excuse me, sorry. This is a lot of high pressure situation for me. I'm having a panic attack real quick. Take a beat. There's nothing wrong with it. And I missed out on so many opportunities just because of that, because I had the fear of embarrassment in front of people because I was going to have a panic attack.
Well,
so.
You were, to end this, to that note, you were, at an office building. You were on what, the 12th, 14th floor, or whatever, of this office building, and having a full blown panic attack, couldn't get in the elevator. He kept going in and out. He called me panicking. and was so worked up and you were so embarrassed to tell someone or talk. Yeah. So I called the building because you couldn't find stairs. And I called the building and was like,
the stairs I tried were locked from the lobby.
I was like, where are your flight? Like, you have a flight of steps here, right? Like, just my husband's there. And I told him, I said, my husband's in there. He's having anxiety. He can't get in the elevator, but he needs to get up to the floor. Found you the steps and you got
And I walked in and then I had to go to that office building all the time and I'd always take the steps.
And one more before, because New York. Biggest fear for him is New York, tall buildings, tight things, whatever.
High-rise buildings, I hate them.
We compromised. He didn't fly. We drove to New York, and we went to this. We went to a photo shoot.
Abby goes, oh, we're on the third floor. I said, golly, that sounds wonderful.
And it was the 34th floor.
Get in the elevator. She hits 34.
I think we told this story before. Oh, but brutal. We compromised. We made it work. He was having a panic attack. I told him, get yourself together. We're fine. We'll and we ended up on the ninth floor. Yeah. And like, that's the thing. It's like, I gave up the, they were like, this is the best room in this hotel. Like, you have the best view. People ask for this room and pay for this room.
Not Josh.
I said, you know what? It's okay. My husband doesn't do heights. And we got on and we were fine. And same as,
and you're like, only sleeping in the room anyway.
Yeah. But so it's compromising. It's talking. We deal with this daily. We're still dealing with it. And you know, I think you're not alone if you're listening to this. If you're in my situation, in my position, or if you're in Josh's position, yeah.
Yep. So I hope that helped at least one person today. Or if you know someone who struggles right now with anxiety or depression or panic, maybe show them this podcast, show them this video.
And they're starting to do landscaping right now. So it's just
they haven't been here all year and now they're out there trimming away, but that's great. So yeah, I think it's important. I think it's good we're getting behind the veil of this scariness of mental health, and especially in men, it's a lot less spoken. And I think it's important we have people come out about it and be open with it, because then it gives the anxiety and panic less power, as I've seen in my 33 years of life. So if I can be a beacon of light to somebody out there who's going through something, gosh, I wish I had somebody who was saying this whenever I was going through it. So I hope I can give it back. And again, I'm always open if you ever want to DM me. Again, I can't give medical advice or anything like that, but I can always give you, you know, I've got your back, and anything I can do to help you. And we'll see you guys next time.
Yeah, I would say they're really picking up that lawnmower right now. I'm sorry they really to be want me to cut this. That was great. But yeah, let us know if you guys have any questions, and we'll see you guys next week.
Wow, that episode flew by. We'll see you guys later.